Professor C. Rajmohan, Director, Institute of South Asian Studies, Singapore, Sri Vinod Rai ji, the author, Sri Sakti Sinha, Director, Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, Sri Kapish Mehra, Managing Director, Rupa Publication India. I could see Chaturvedi ji sitting in front of me, and also my old friend Mr. Panda, and also a lot of senior civil servants in service and retired from service, brothers and sisters. It gives me great pleasure to release Sri Vinod Rai's book, Rethinking Good Governance, an important and timely analysis of India's public institutions that reflect our national character. I congratulate Sri Rai for presenting his profound insights on various institutions in a brilliantly lucid, keenly observant, steadfastly honest, and finely balanced manner. The book offers a scholarly analysis of the country's key accountability agencies, whose functions underpin and affect all facets of life in India. Sri Rai ji has always pointed out that the vital bond between the people and the government is that of trust, and the public institutions are the custodians of that trust. Sri Rai begins by making a profound statement. He says that accountability in institutions script the destiny of nations. He repeated the same thing. I tend to agree with his statement. The accountability institutions support good governance, which promotes sustainable development and welfare of the people. It has also been proven beyond doubt that economic development efforts cannot be sustained over time without good governance platforms that can foster and nurture them. Azadi ke baad deshwasi ne socha, Azadi mil gaya to Swaraj mil gaya to Swaraj Suraj ban jayega. That's the expectation of the people. And this theme of the book also is the same. What is good governance? Suraj, where people can be comfortable, people can be happy, and they enjoy life in a free country. He emphasizes upon the need for supreme audit institutions to shift from the conventional audit of public expenditure to public accountability, and calls upon the civil service to be more professional and responsive. Through his astute commentary present in the book, Sri Rai focused on institutions such as Parliament, the Supreme Court, the Election Commission, the Controller and Auditor General of India, Central Vigilance Commission, and the Central Information Commission, among others. Leveraging his long and distinguished innings in public life, he has done a commendable job of proposing a reform agenda, suggesting how the credibility of these institutions, once eroded, can be restored. My dear sisters and brothers, today's India is surging forward, fueled by its vibrant economy, supported by its scientific and technological progress, aided and abetted by the energy of its bourgeoising youth population, and helmed by a stable and progressive government. The Prime Minister's zeal to reform, transform India is being translated into many ambitious programs and reforms that are putting our country on a new and distinctly faster trajectory, resulting in so many exciting achievements. His mantra, three-line mantra, reform, perform, and transform, has given a new impetus to the transformational development of our country. Today, we are dreaming of being a 5 trillion economy by 24 and 25. Reaching this lucrative goal would call for nothing short of combined and united effort of the government, the public institutions, and the civil society. The far-reaching, path-breaking reforms must be further accelerated through citizen-centric, technology-oriented, robust, transparent, responsive, flexible, and adaptable good governance practices. As we step into the 73rd year of our independence, it is crucial that we ponder over the current situation of our three state organs, the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary, and see how we can further strengthen these three pillars. Through my long and rewarding career as a parliamentarian, I have always maintained that parliamentary democracy is all about ensuring governance through accountability to the people. In fact, three important functions of the legislature are legislative, deliberative, and accountability. While some legislative bodies are functioning well, in many of them, there is certain considerable room for improvement. It's all because of protocol, they have used this phrase. Had it been Venkaiah Naidu original, it would have been little different. I am not used to reading speeches also. But, you know, what is happening in parliament, in legislatures across the country, is really worrying people. As a chairman of the Rajya Sabha, as a member of parliament for more than four terms, and also member of legislative assembly, and also a political functionary, including being head of a ruling party, I feel that there is every need for all of us, and particularly people who are in public life, and particularly people who are in legislature, to rethink, retrospect, and reorient their responses to the responsibility that is given to them. Because parliament, we are supposed to be the role models to others. And when people look at parliament, they get disappointed, disillusioned at times. We are the largest parliamentary democracy in the world. And we must strive to become finest parliamentary democracy in the world. There is scope, and the standards set by our senior parliamentarians, they are really great. And there is a lot of scope, provided if political parties, I call it parties, they all commit themselves to the rule of law and also to parliamentary decorum, decency, and go by the formula. Parliament is there to discuss, debate, and decide, not disrupt. Three Ds, as Pranab Mukherjee has said, or people are more prone to fourth D, disruption. Disruption, obstruction, negativism has become part of our public life, unfortunately. We should not forget that we are a free India. We are ruling ourselves. We are no longer ruled by foreigners. And by adopting a negative attitude, a destructive attitude, leaving the constructive path, we are harming ourselves. This has to be understood by one and all. I also tell parliamentarians, parliament, let the government propose. Let the opposition oppose. Let the house dispose. That is the only way. The opposition must have its say. But in democracy, the government must have its way. Because people have given them mandate. People have given them. So first thing one must learn, one must practice, is be tolerant towards the mandate of the people. Yes, this state or that state, this party or that party, that is not the issue. The issue is we must be tolerant to the mandate of the people. Be critical and take maximum advantage of the opportunities available, but at the same time, maintain standards. Follow decency and decorum. This is what is required. The Constitution has vested the Parliament with sufficient instruments through which it can enforce accountability of the government. However, efficacy of these institutions can only be as good as the parliamentarians and political parties who deploy them. That's why I started now telling public also, you must select and elect good people. And you deserve the government which you elect. हमारे देश में क्या होता है चुनाव के संदर्भ में लोग इश्यूज उठाते हैं और कहते हैं ये कहते वो ये वो ये अच्छा नहीं वो अच्छा नहीं अच्छा नहीं और वोट करते समय और दूसरी कंसीडरेशन के आधार पर वोट करते सो दैट्स व्हाई आई सजेस्ट पीपल शुड सेलेक्ट एंड इलेक्ट देयर लीडर्स एंड रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ फोर सीज कैरेक्टर कैलिबर कैपेसिटी एंड कॉन्डक्ट बट सम ऑफ द पॉलिटिशियंस हैव डिवाइसड न्यू मेथड शॉर्टकट मेथड द अदर फोर सीज कास्ट community, cash, and criminality. we should also seriously think about the role played by an effective opposition in a parliamentary democracy can never be undermined. The opposition must have its say, irrespective of the number. But at the same time, the parliament or the legislative body must be allowed to function. If you function, then you will get an opportunity. If you don't allow the house to function, then, and it has become a habit now rushing into the well of the house. I think late Rajagopalachari has said, if I'm right, if you are not well on the facts, go to the well of the house. Confront the government, corner the government, expose the government. But at the same time, allow the parliament to function. Let everyone have his say. That is what is required. That's why I suggest to political parties, because and I talk to MPs privately and call them to my room and say, what is happening? Why are you doing this? Sir, sorry, what can I do, sir? Instruction from the party. So I have come to the conclusion that we must address the parties. And parties must evolve a code of conduct for their representatives about their presence in the house, about their functioning in the house, about their contribution in the house, about their conduct in public life. And political parties must put it in the election manifesto. What is it they are going to offer on the legislative front to the people? Time has come, now we should insist on that and demand our political parties, what is your legislative agenda? That should be but disrupting the proceedings of the House is not the way forward. The Rai points out in the book that during the 11th Lok Sabha, 1977, 5.2% of the time was lost due to disruptions. But in the 13th Lok Sabha, 94-2004, 18.9% of the time was lost. And the figure rose to 19.6% in the 14th Lok Sabha. If you take a 15th and 16th, it will be much more. The 15th Lok Sabha saw an appalling 39% of its time lost because of disruptions. This is truly a distressing trend and must not be allowed to continue under any circumstances. But unfortunately, what is happening is these facts are not being discussed. I'm happy. A renowned author like him has pointed out this. Because some people think that by commenting on parliament, will it attract contempt? Second is, the people think that it's not an attractive news. Media also is partly responsible to this. I hope there are some media people, along with political parties. The reason is they don't report the contribution made by constructive discussion by parliamentarians. They report only highlights of some obstruction or somebody behaving in a most irresponsible manner. That becomes the news. And this, I remember my own personal experience when I came to parliament first time. I'm very much fond of agriculture. I'm son of a farmer. Agriculture is our basic culture. That's my belief. So I made a study, serious study, and came to parliament. And I spoke in parliament for 52 minutes on agriculture. Everybody, right from M.S. Swaminathan to Karad Pawar to different party leaders, they came to me and they complimented me. Very good speech. Next day, no newspaper has published anything of my speech, except one newspaper said, Mr. Naidu made a very constructive sessions on the issues of agriculture. Two lines. If you go to the well, you are in the news. If you break the mic, you are in the news. If you throw the papers, you are in the news. If you tear your shirt, your own shirt, not the other man's, you are in the news. Some people did like this in the recent session. My suggestion is media should highlight the obstructionist behavior as well as the constructive approach or contribution made by members. Then members will start developing interest. Otherwise, members kahte sir, matlab kya hai? Itna tayari karke aaye. Mauka milta nahi, mauka mile to bhi koi chapta bhi nahi. So that's a disappointment. So this is where, first one is political parties, accountability through their manifesto, giving a commitment, and then reviewing the commitment later. Second is media, of objectively passing on the information to the people. And you must give correct information, because information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. If you give correct information, people can really, can. Because that's why about the report given by the CAG, people are asking, what, how does these figures come? A lot of debate, of course. It has taken a political turn rather than a constructive debate. That's a different matter. As I have repeatedly emphasized in my public speeches, I would like legislators across the country to discuss, debate, decide, but not disrupt. We must realize today's enlightened citizenry, especially the youth, are watching actions of parliamentarians very closely and questioning their actions, motives, and attitudes, not only within the house, but also outside as well. We are fortunate, 65% of our Indian population is below 35 years. We have got a great demographic dividend. It's a great opportunity, but at the same time, great challenge. Now, the Indian youth are very aspirational. They aspire and they demand. So people who are the policymakers, are the people who are the implementing agencies, or the institutions, must be aware of this new emerging trend, which is a welcoming trend in the country, and then try to raise up to the expectations of the people. The parliamentarians must also be mindful and respectful of the aspirations of the common man and carry on with the rectitude and propriety, serving as a model citizens of the country. There is also a general perception that the quality of debates in parliament has been declining. We need legislators who are well-informed and well-intentioned and capable of articulating as well as present viewpoint, not those who are eager to rush to the well of the house. Recently, we are unfortunate to lose three eminent great parliamentarians, starting with Sri Jaipal Reddy, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, and Sri Arun Jaitley. Brilliant, very articulative, very informative, and also used to be very polite. We must have such many more examples. Unfortunately, God has been unkind. He has taken away my best parliamentarians. The political parties, as I said earlier, should adopt a code of conduct for their legislators and contribute to policy making through informed decisions. Political parties must also very carefully choose candidates based upon their capacity, caliber, conduct, and raise above narrow consideration of caste, religion that seek to divide the society. It is indeed a matter of great concern. The Inter-Parliamentary Union ranked India 153 of 190 nations in the proportion of women in parliament. We must take special care to ensure that the parliament is truly a representational body and give more prominence to increasing the number of women parliamentarians and parliamentarians from other marginalized sections also. My dear sisters and brothers, India is undergoing a rapid transformation. A number of progressive policy interventions, legislations and programs such as Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, goods and service tax, from striking down triple talaq to the implementation of Ayushman Bharat, touted to be the world's largest free healthcare scheme, India is undergoing a 360-degree transformation. Visionary programs such as Swachh Bharat, Make in India, Digital India, Startup India, Skill India has put up India on the path of rapid reforms. But these should become people's movement. Unfortunately, politicians over the years, of course, I was also a politician till the other day. Now I'm retired from politics, but not tired from public life. That's why. Made people to think that everything, this is the government work, this is the corporator's work, this is MLS work, this is MP's work. Everything will be done by the government. Sab kaam sarkar karega, hum bekar baithe to chalega. Aisa nahi chalega. People's involvement is very much required. If people's involvement is there through transparency of the governmental systems, then you can demand accountability also, and you will know accountability also if you involve in the programs. And the primary duty of the government and the policy makers and political leadership is to see that the people also are involved. The amount of success, whatever it is, Swachh Bharat have achieved is because of people's participation. Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, people's participation, change of mindset. That is what is required. It is not the question of money alone, Swachh Bharat, it's the question of mindset. So So you have to bring about changes in the mindset of people. That will come by proper education of the people, by well-meaning people, well-intentioned people, and also policymakers. The book that way will be very useful to inspire people and to have a critical thinking of what is happening, what are the requirements to make changes, etc. These results of all these schemes are built on strong foundations of a robust governance system. Making laws and policies is only part of the story. Implementing and executing them is more crucial aspect of governance. The bureaucracy plays an important role. Designing programs intelligently, funding them sustainably, monitoring their implementation consistently, and evaluating their outcomes scientifically is the crux of good governance. I repeat, designing programs intelligently, funding them sustainably, monitoring their implementation consistently, and evaluating their outcomes scientifically is the crux of good governance. We need constantly evaluate our governance strategies and its outcomes and be flexible and open through to bring about course corrections whenever necessary. There should be no gap between policy intent and policy implementation. The intended benefits of a program must reach the people in time. The quality of service delivery is an area that needs more attention than what is being done today. A lot of improvement has come, but still there is scope for further improvement. At the end of the day, success of democracy, success of any system lies in delivery. Delivery is more important. Formulation, okay, you can do. Even your intention may be good also. You may allocate good budget and you may have good officers. At the end of the day, unless it reaches the people, great Raju Gandhiji, former Prime Minister, he made a statement, famous statement. If I send 100 rupees from Delhi, by the time it reaches Thiruvananthapuram or Ananthapuram, it will be only 15 rupees. He made that statement out of agony, real concern. That's the problem today. You must see to it that it reaches the people. That's why the new ideas, new programs of online, digitalization, then DBT, then this financial literacy, then Janadhana. I can share with you when this Janadhana was introduced. PM said, we should see to it that everybody opens a bank account. I was being senior. I said, yes, sir, we'll do it. During our tenure, we'll complete that. Because it's a huge task. PM said, our tenure? I said, yes. A thing which could not be done in 58 years, if we can do it in 4 years, really it's good. He said, no, jaldi karna padega. Jaldi mane? Maybe 1.5 years, 2 years. PM is PM. Everybody kept quiet. But I can tell you today happily, 36 crore bank accounts have been opened. By whom? By the same bank employees. No OT. Everybody has done their duty. OT means overtime allowance. So that means if you intend and if you guide, you can deliver. And even of course, there is no dearth of skeptical people in our country. People start saying, "Arey, paisa na hai to khata kholne mein matlab kya hai ji?" That was immediate in our country. We are always start thinking in sometimes negative. Paisa na hai to khata kholne ka matlab kya hai? People who raise such apprehensions, they got the reply on 2016 November 10th evening, 8 o'clock, when PM came on television and started saying, Bhaiyo aur Behno, then people started looking to their drivers, to their cooks and assistant. Arey bhai, aapke paas to account hai na? Kuch din ke rahe bhai, paisa usme rakh sakta ho, kya hai? Now, you have seen reports also, how many lakhs of people have put their money into the other's account. That verification should be completed by Reserve Bank and also income tax at the earliest to reach the bottom of the truth. So this is the power, reaching the unreached, funding the unfunded, recognizing the unrecognized. That should be the priority. And secondly, DBT, direct benefit transfer, scholarship, pension, compensation, insurance. Your entitlement must come to you. You need not go around the offices. Go, stand online, wait in the line, go and meet the person, greet the person, shake hand, do something in between hand, and then only get things done. That is the system. Let us be very frank. I know I'm a constitutional responsible person, but still I'm making that statement at various levels. At various levels. I'm not talking about one government, this government or that government, this time or that time, all that. So we have to address that problem and see that things are done online. Online. Everything should, in future, if you want to have really good governance, you have to think on those lines. I'm happy the system is thinking about it. There is positive improvement also coming. That should be our head. I've been in Estonia 1 month back, small country. I was sharing some of my this thing with Vinod Rai and Sekti. The country is totally digital. Small country, of course, but small also. Totally digital, no paper work at all. Country, we say India is once upon a time Vishwa Guru, knowledge center. Why can't we do it? Efforts are on, but these efforts must be expedited, accelerated, and see to it that we become digital. So some of these problems of delivery can be addressed. That is very important. And also reaching out the unreached. Dr. Ambedkar, Mahatma Gandhi, Dindal Upadhyay, everybody said, the last man in the sitting last man, not in this auditorium, the society. We should uplift him. Uplifting the poorest of the poor, suppressed, depressed, oppressed people. Antim pankti mein baithe, unka uttan pahle hona chahiye. This priority has to be there in the system, among the administrators, among the politicians. Then it reaches the really intended people. We must also ensure that fruits of democratic good governance reach everyone, especially the ones which are at the farthest end of the development spectrum. Results-based management should become the norm. One way to make delivery of service more efficient is through use of digital technologies. India has embarked upon an ambitious Digital India mission intended to drive governance and the delivery of service online, thereby eliminating middlemen and infusing greater transparency and accountability of our systems. I have also observed that government programs tend to succeed when people get enthused and participate in the implementation of the program. I strongly believe decentralization of powers and responsibilities to local bodies needs to be more efficiently implemented as per the constitutional provisions of 73 and 74th Amendment, where 29 subjects were supposed to be devolved to local bodies. Three Fs, funds, functions, and functionaries. They should be devolved to the local bodies because they are at the lowest above the government system and all. The funds, functions, and functionaries must be transferred to these institutions. I'm happy. 14th Finance Commission has made some recommendations. Government have accepted it. Money is going directly to panchayats and municipal bodies. It should improve further. This will bring governance closer to people and enhance credibility of the effectiveness. My dear sisters and brothers, it is not only the legislature and the executive that should become more accountable to people. The judicial process too must become more people-friendly. Only an efficient, transparent, accessible and affordable judicial system can become a key touchstone of good governance, which can improve ease of doing business as well as ease of living. Over the years, a number of reforms have made our judicial systems more robust and responsive, but we have to go a long way. The Chief Justice of India recently talked about heavy pendency of cases in various courts. Apparently, there are 60,000 cases pending in Supreme Court and 44 lakh cases in high courts, and there are around 3 crore cases in different courts. The dictum that justice delayed is justice denied. This has to be understood by one and all, those people who are in the government, those people who are there at the helm of affairs of the judiciary. Therefore, the most urgent judicial reform necessary is the elimination of judicial delays and the improvement of efficiency of the justice system. The government needs to be much more proactive in addressing the large number of pending vacancies in the judicial system so that delays are avoided. As regards the election, I am repeating what I have said sometime back in Chennai, because this is very, very important. The election cases pending before various courts. I'll just give an example. I don't want to name the person. He contested the election in 2009. There was a dispute. First declared as been defeated, then won. 2009 over. 2014 over. 2019 over. Still the case is going on. What is the matlab kya hai? People are asking, what is the fun? 9, 14, 19. I don't know whether it will be over before 24. It's a a very sad commentary. I am not making any personal this thing or anything. Sad commentary of our system. Even I have personal experience. I disposed of one defection case. I am of the opinion that defection cases should be decided in 3 months. You do not even require 3 months also, to be frank, because I have dealt with one case and decided expeditiously. Then appeal. By December, we'll be completing 2 years. The case has not been heard. That situation, is it a sign of a healthy democracy? Then one of the retired judges told me, recently retired judges told me, I was hearing cases of 30 years old, 25 years old, criminal cases. 25-year-old criminal case. So the fellow is alive or not, or might have undergone treatment in jail. So this is a very serious situation, like a legislative situation, which I described to you. This judicial situation also requires reforms. And all of people concerned, government, judicial people who are in authority and others, they should all contribute to this. Election petitions and criminal cases against political leaders must be decided quickly by special benches of higher courts in a time-bound manner. This is my advice. Because criminal case pending for years together against politicians, what respect that gentleman will have or gentlewoman will have in the society if the case is pending, murder case. The two serious cases involving moral turpitude, corruption, criminal and all. So I feel that criminal cases of politicians, the two elected representatives, they should be disposed of by special tribunals set up by the court separately in a time-bound manner. Same thing should apply to defection cases. They should also be dealt by separate benches. Otherwise, if you go through regular process of a high court, then Supreme Court and all, you are seeing what is happening and all. But I am also of the opinion that the Supreme Court must also think seriously, and government and parliament should take initiative. The Supreme Court must have different benches. One in south, one in east, one in west. So that the people need not come all the way from Thiruvananthapuram coming to Delhi for a case and then spending money and engaging a Supreme Court lawyer. I hope that important lawyers are not here, but you know how costly it is engaging a senior counsel in Supreme Court. For such small cases also, why can't be the benches? And this is there in the Constitution. I don't want to take your time. Constitution provides for the same. Any delays in these cases erode public confidence in the judicial and legislative bodies. The defection cases should be decided by the Speaker or the Chairman within 3 months. This is my suggestion, that there be debate on this. And I can give you two examples without giving the names. 20 plus MLAs of the opposition joined the ruling party. Some of them became ministers. Case was filed. The chair never decided. The tenure is over. No elections are held. Another government came. In another state, 23 MLAs again. Opposition joined ruling party. Some of them became ministers. Anti-defection cases were filed, but no disposal. What is it? So their 10th schedule gives the power to chairman. I am not getting into the chairman or legislative council chairman or speaker. But there should be time. Prescription. Within 3 months, one must dispose it of. Otherwise, if you just sit on that petition and then your tenure is over, again fresh assembly is elected, same thing repeats. I would suggest that we should have special judicial tribunals which will decide the cases within a reasonable time, or let us say 6 months or at most 1 year, these criminal cases. I would also suggest that we revisit the 10th schedule of our Constitution containing anti-defection provisions to ensure a time-bound disposal of such cases and make it more effective by plugging loopholes. It is heartening that the government have recently enhanced the number of judges in the Supreme Court by 10%, but I am afraid it may be still inadequate. We also need to bring the judicial system closer to the people. There is a need to improve court management and infrastructure facilities, especially in the lower courts. The endless possibilities of information technology may be leveraged for state e-filing and online case management. Expanding the Supreme Court bench and having a separate bench in different regions as per the recommendation of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Law and Justice. That should really be attended to by the Supreme Court and by the government. As the Law Commission has suggested, there is a need for a division of the Supreme Court into a constitutional bench, a DC, and a secession benches in four regions. This is also a very important suggestion worth considering. I tend to agree with this recommendation. I think it's high time we had more benches, because in a country as vast as India, the litigants have to travel long distance and spend a huge amount of money and energy. The number of civil and criminal cases have been pending over 25 years. This makes me think that we need to not only expand the Supreme Court, but also divide the work into constitutional division and number of legal divisions or courts of appeal. As the Law Commission has suggested, I would like the Supreme Court to have two divisions, one dealing with constitutional matters and another with the appeals. This suggestion merits serious consideration and decision by the Supreme Court as well as the government, because it would enable the Supreme Court to devote more time to constitutional issues and make it more accessible to common people. As regards the need for division of the apex court in four regions, Article 130 of the Constitution states, the Supreme Court shall sit in Delhi or in such other places or place or places as the Chief Justice of India may, with the approval of the President, from time to time. This is very clear. Provision is there. There is no need for any constitutional amendment also. The suggestions of the Chief Justice of India to raise the retirement age of High Court judges and make tenure appointments to clear the backlog seems to be a pragmatic solution to the in the current context. This is also a suggestion worth considering. My dear sisters and brothers, it is clear there must be a synergy in the working of the three limbs of the state, legislature and executive and the judiciary. But the three organs of the state perform their duties well when they do not transgress into each other's territory. That is also a worrying area now. Everyone has been assigned a particular responsibility. They should not cross or transgress. The welfare of the common man must be enduring theme of our vision for transforming India. Let me remind you of the talisman given by Mahatma Gandhi. He said, and I quote, whenever you are in doubt or when the self becomes too much with you, apply the following test. Recall the face of the poorest and the weakest man whom you may have seen and ask yourself, if the step you contemplate is going to be of any use to him, will he gain anything by it? Will it restore him to a control over his own life and destiny? In other words, will it lead to Swaraj for the hungry and spiritually starving millions? Then you will find your doubts and yourself melt away. This is what Mahatma Gandhi has said. The issues raised in Rethinking Good Governance about the most important institutions that sustain and nourish our democracy are indeed noteworthy. And I hope that book receives the attention and appreciation of the people, and there is a well-meaning discussion across the country, so that informed discussions always will be useful to come into better decisions. I would like to place on record my appreciation for the publisher, Rupa Publications of India, and in particular, Mr. Kapish Mehra, for bringing out such a worthy publication. You are saying that my hand, there is something luck and all. I don't know whether it is there or not. But I came here because of the subject and because of Sri Vinod Rai. Vinod Rai is one of our most brilliant, outstanding civil servant the country has produced. I'm happy. I'm happy I'm here today, this evening, to share some of my thoughts about this book and also about contemporary issues that has been raised in this book. And I'm happy that there is a good gathering of people here, well-meaning people, senior people. They all will not only read the book, but also discuss the subjects raised in the book. Once again, congratulations, Vinod Rai ji, for the good work you have done. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.